Good morning. We're glad you're with us.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
It's good to have you worshiping with us today. You may remember a couple of months ago I wrote about how during this COVID time we've been doing a lot of pivoting. Oh, we did a big pivot this morning with the wind and the rain, and it's quite windy out there right now. We decided that online worship today is the best way for us to go. So we're so glad you're worshiping with us today online. Thanks to all you guys, too. I'm so glad you're back here and playing for us. And you can't see him, but David's over at the piano over here to my right as well. It's good to have you worshiping with us. Just a couple of announcements. Tomorrow is Labor Day, so our offices will be closed. So we won't be having our in-gathering of food for the Grace Welcome Center tomorrow. We will have it a week from tomorrow. If you get emails from us, you got a shopping list, a really good shopping list of things that they are in need of over at Grace. Please note at the bottom there, if you've been saving up all those grocery bags and they're overflowing a closet in your house, Grace really needs them to help our folks get groceries home. So please bring those over a week from tomorrow. We'll also have the jigsaw puzzle exchange going on as well during that time. Also a reminder, next Sunday afternoon at 4:00, we are very happy to host the ordination to the Ministry of Word and Sacrament for John Anderson. We had to postpone it a couple of weeks ago, but we are going to get him ordained next Sunday. We're going to make sure this happens. So we really hope you can come. It'll be at 4:00 in the afternoon. Bring your grape juice, bring your bread for communion, and we will be worshiping in the parking lot in our vehicles. I hope you can come and join us. It's going to be a really joyous and really fun day. So I hope you can be there with us. That's all I have for this morning. Let us begin our time of worship together with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who creates, redeems, and sustains us in all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways.
We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God hears the cries of all who call out in need. And through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. Our opening song for today is Here's My Heart.
Let us pray. O Lord God, enliven and preserve your church with your perpetual mercy. Without your help, we mortals will fail. Remove far from us everything that is harmful, and lead us toward all that gives life and salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The first reading is from Romans 13. Owe no one anything except to love one another. for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Our gospel reading for today is from Matthew, the 18th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. A number of years ago, I got a rather disturbing phone call from my brother Dave. It was an incoherent phone call. It was rambling. He was repeating himself. Something just wasn't right with Dave. It bothered me enough that I called my brother Jim and said, "Would you give him a call and see what you think?" A short time later, Jim called me back and said, "Something's not right." Now, you know, brothers, we don't agree on everything. So when we agree on something, even if it's something's not right, it's kind of a bonus day in many ways for brothers. Something was so not right for Jim that he jumped on a plane and went down to see my brother, who was living in southern New Mexico at the time. He called me up shortly after arriving and he said, "Boy, something is really not right." He said on Dave's desk there was a huge stack of bills that hadn't been paid, that his well had broken down for his water, and so he bought bottled water from the store, but he obviously kept forgetting that he had bought bottled water from the store, so his bathtub was filled with bottles of water. And he wasn't working because he couldn't remember the passwords even to get into his computer. Something was really wrong. So Jim got plane tickets and brought him back up to Wisconsin so that he could be looked at by a specialist. You see, Dave, the company that he worked for, to see a specialist or to be admitted to a hospital, you had to have either an office or a factory for that company to reside in that state. And there wasn't that in New Mexico. He was doing everything online. So in Wisconsin, that particular company has factories and has offices, so he could have an exam. What it turned out that David had was a tumor that was on his brain. Now, what I learned from the doctors later is that we all have them. They're very, very small tumors, and they lie in the layers just outside of the brain itself. And every once in a while, they get big. In David's case, it got big. Almost grapefruit size, that tumor had grown so much that it pressed against his brain and caused just odd behaviors that he had. Well, you know, when a doctor tells you, by the way, that I've never seen anything like this, it gives you pause. You know, it makes you a little bit nervous when a doctor says something like that. But it all went well. And he spent about 3 months in Wisconsin just recovering. Finally was able to go back to his home in New Mexico. To get there, he had to fly to Atlanta and then down into southern Texas, down to El Paso, then get in a vehicle and drive back to his home. That's how far south he was in New Mexico. When he was at the Atlanta airport, he called me. And I could tell very quickly that he was troubled about something. And I asked him, what is it that's making you so upset? I said, was it the travel? I mean, did it bump you around and are you feeling off or what's going on? And he said, no. It's something else, something bigger. For the first time, he started to tell me what his life had been like with this brain tumor. He shared that he had lots and lots of people to apologize to. There was a time in a post office where he just started ranting and raving and yelling at the postal workers or with the cable guy and many other people. He had said horrible things to people, really racist things to quite a number of people. Living in southern New Mexico, you get the picture. He asked me, how do I do this? How do I go back and face all of these people? How do I ask for forgiveness? Where do I start? What if they just shut the door on me and turn me away? Well, I did my best to try to assure him of a number of things. You know, first that people knew. I knew. Jim knew. Everybody around you no doubt knew that you were not yourself. Second, if people don't believe you, take your hat off. Show them the big scar on the side of your head. That might get some people to start believing you. And third, and most importantly, you have to do this. You have to ask them for forgiveness. The person you wronged, frankly, may or may not forgive you, but you have to try. Be honest with them. Own your words. Yes, you had a brain tumor, and that did kind of augment your personality and things, but don't pass it off. Own your words. Listen to the other person. Show them how important they are to you. Let them know that you love them. Jesus tells us a lot in today's reading about what we should do if someone sins against us. And his advice is solid advice. More than advice, it really is talking about a way to live as a community. Too often, and I think especially during these COVID months, with all of its anxiety and the anxiety of the last couple of weeks, we just let it go. We just erupt. We just tell anybody and everybody that we've been harmed. And with social media and email, we have even more avenues to just blast it out there, sometimes without thinking, but always without going to the person who we believed has sinned against us. By the way, for those of us who are those sounding boards, the people that others call and say, oh, I'm just so angry about what so-and-so did to me. we have to take on a responsibility to pay attention to Jesus' words as well and say, you know, I think you need to go to that person and you need to talk to them about that. And if that doesn't work, I'll go with you. Oh, that's a risky thing, isn't it? I'll go with you as well and help. Jesus said, if the member listens to you, you have regained the one. But if you're not listened to, take or one or two along with you so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. Let's not forget what this passage is about. This passage is about confession. This passage is about reconciliation between the one who has sinned and the one who feels they have been sinned against. What this is not, is it is not conflict resolution. This is about sin against one person and another. Because let's face it, as human beings, we disagree. We disagree a lot. I would like to think we agree more than we disagree, but it happens. One person's truth isn't always the truth of another person. This is different than what Jesus was talking about. Disagreement is not necessarily sin. Unresolved disagreement, well, that's another story. When there is disagreement, our first reading today, this letter from Paul to a very fractured community in Rome, is where we can start. He writes, "Owe no one anything." I love these words. Owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Love means that we don't think the worst in everybody, but we try to think the best. That we're willing to listen far more than we are willing to talk. That while we may continue to disagree, because that happens, that even happens in the church, believe it or not, the disagreement's still there. That doesn't mean that we can't keep moving forward with Christ's mission in our congregation and community. Love means that you don't just walk away because of a disagreement. Paul also writes, and any other commandment are summed up in these words, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is fulfilling the law. My brother Dave did go to those people. I mean, you think about that. What a difficult thing to do. Imagine how hard it would be to have to go to one person and confess your sin to them. And then imagine having to go to multiple people and having to do that over and over again. I'm still so very proud of him that he did it. It took a lot of guts. He found courage within himself to restore these relationships, to work at it, to return and renew this sense of community he had with these folks. He took the hard work head on, so to speak, wink, wink. He took head on the work of love. Julie is laughing at me over and thinking, man, that's a terrible bad joke. Yeah, I admit it. You know, in our community, it's been so obvious over these last 2 weeks that we've got a lot of work to do. We've got a lot of confessing of our own guilt, of the racism that is in our front thoughts, but also that's deep-seated in our own souls. We're called to love. We're called to love this community of faith here at St. Mary's. We're called to love this greater community, which is Kenosha, and we're called to love our entire world as well. And we will. And we will love one another by confessing, by speaking truths, by listening, by supplying food and clothing for those who are in need. We will show that we love one another as much as we love our own selves. by working for justice and for peace. Justice and peace that will last because we're going to do the hard work. Showing this kind of love helps us to lay aside those works of darkness and really do put on that armor of light. That armor of light, which is love, that flows through Jesus to us, to our community here at St. Mary's, but more importantly, to our community that's outside of these doors. Amen.
Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Our petition will be, Lord, in your mercy, and our response will be, hear our prayer. Unite your church, O God. Grant us the gifts of repentance and reconciliation. Bless the cooperative work of churches in this community as we work for an end to racism in Kenosha. Strengthen ecumenical partnerships, guide the work of the Lutheran World Federation and the World Council of Churches. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Protect your creation, O God. Teach us ways that do not harm what you have entrusted to our care. Renew and enliven places suffering from drought, flood, storms, or pollution. We pray especially for all who are affected by wildfires in western states and hurricanes in the southern states. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Turn nations and leaders from ways that lead to death. Shape new paths toward peace and cooperation, teaching us to recognize one another as neighbors. Guide legislators, civil servants, judges, and police toward laws that protect the well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Tend to all in need of your compassion. Hear the cries of those awaiting justice and those yearning for forgiveness. Give community to the lonely and neighbors to the outcast. Shelter all who are vulnerable in body, mind, or spirit. Today we remember before you Dean, Diana, Liam, Marilyn, Edie, Judy, Frank, and Chrissy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sustain us in our work, O God, and give work to those who need it. Shape societies to ensure fair treatment for all who labor. Help us to love our neighbors in and through our work. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share that peace with one another. God's peace to you all.
For everyone watching at home, I invite you to get your bread and your grape juice or wine ready for communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We lift our hearts to you, Lord God, because you draw your whole creation into the celebration of your glory. Send down your Holy Spirit upon us, that every part of every one of us might become instruments of peace. Give us your very self in these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of Jesus, who at supper on the night in which he was betrayed took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took a cup of wine, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." God of justice, make us a prophetic people whose every work and every act is a proclamation of the new order found in you and worthy of your kingdom. Holy God, make us a priestly people whose lives are so transparent with your truth that we become a place of encounter between you and beloved children. Reigning God, make us a people whose hearts are filled with worship and wonder, and who seek to bring every one of your good gifts to fruition in the power of your Spirit. We pray in union with Christ, in the power of your Holy Spirit, God of glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. This is the body of Christ given for me. This is the blood of Christ shed for me.
This is the body of Christ for me. This is the blood of Christ shed for me.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Peace be with you. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, that you have once again fed us with food beyond compare, the body and blood of Christ. Lead us from this place, nourished and forgiven, into your beloved vineyard to wipe away the tears of all who hunger and thirst, guided by the example of the same Jesus Christ and led by the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
I'm having trouble remembering to turn my mic on. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
We sing our closing song.
teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.